Good afternoon on a Sunday afternoon. Thank you so much for having logged in. I gather we have a pan country logins already, and we have people logged from various locations. Thank you for coming in, and sorry for disturbing you on a Saturday afternoon siesta. Post lunch, when we get down to back to basics and look at the relaxation we have in our lives, we don't have overactive bladder and we don't have a UTI at this point in time. We're dealing with somebody who is dealing with bladder pain. And of the focus individuals, colleagues, respected teachers and guests, those who have logged in today, we are dealing with a subject of agony, despair, discontent, living and waiting, when and how will I get sorted. So I speak on behalf of Team Urology at the Kokilam Dhirubhai Ambani Hospital in Mumbai, and welcome to all of you on a continued global threat and sad scenarios of the world being at crossroads, where we are attempting to find our bearings right. Many other departments do work from home, but from medical community, more of surgical and emergency community, we are back in the society. At this point, while we grapple with various diseases and get to learn each other, and have made friends with so many colleagues who have been doing great work on various subjects, and including this subject, where we did talk to a few people. They wanted us to present the same presentation, which has actually gone on a few times, to look at creating their own map, their own team, and taking it forward. So while we are grappling with global threat and diseases and phenomena which is taking a toll on us, we also look at the wings of change. The wings of change were what were there all the time while we moved from the era of Google Classic to the new Google, which took us from 30 days to 30 microseconds to get something on. We also looked at the winds of change last year. Sadly, the most proud carrier actually gave way to somebody else, and these winds of change are not unknown. So while we completely prepare ourselves and motivate ourselves, we activated ourselves 34 days ago when the lockdown started. We persisted in various ways to take ourselves to the high levels and not be lazy. We answer our patients on telephones and WhatsApp and Skype consults. Any of us go back to the emergency departments as gynecologists, as urologists, as pain therapists, intensivists, everybody. The intensity that we have kept up on medical science is extremely high, which means that as medical and specialized personnel, our motivation is high and internal, and we challenge ourselves with a daily goal, which is more so brought about by various patients, especially in this subject, where we reward ourselves feeling good that all our training and all our meetings and all our teamwork, which we built up on the subject, has actually been true. So while we keep learning by webinars and by listening to teachers every day, it's also sharing some experience like the one from the platform created by Ciplamed. Thank you so much for this. Reading, listening, observing, and taking it back to the clinics where patients would get well is about being in motion. And being in motion creates emotion, not of the kind where we would delve deep into anything but treatment. We hope forward this lockdown goes over, COVID times get better, and we hang out with friends again, and we hang out with our superstars in life. I'm hopeful that handshake is not dead, and handshake is not deadly forever. What all motivates you is teamwork, because we alone can't do. What motivated us in our childhood were these games, which have given way to newer faces altogether. And we sat down together as a team back home, four of us, and looked at the new game. Socially distancing each other rather than sitting together, we knew that was a little different scenario altogether. I think with whatever we look at right now, we will continue doing better with passing time as we combine together. So the whole modus operandi today is to combine together in patients who are actually ignited in the trouble and pain and burning which happened there. But what inspires you and me is our workplace, as our profession, is our continued endeavor that we look at. That's a wonderful picture, Doc. Thank you for sending me this on the pink night, the night we celebrate once every week, every year around the hospital. So what inspires me and all my team members and members of medical community across the country is a workplace where we go and find our own bearings right, and we continue polishing ourselves. We also look forward to following this motto, every life matters, which means today we are going to improve the quality of life of so many individuals who go through this agony, pain, discomfort, discontent, and desperation out of a disease called interstitial cystitis bladder pain syndrome. So greetings from Kokilam Dhirubhai Ambani Hospital, and I must not forget that we have a great team. As I said, we're talking about team in every subject, and out here there's a big core team of individuals who actually have given the foundation to the department and the subject, and consultants, Joy, Dr. Ismail, myself, and then Dr. Navita Purohit, who happens to be a very strong backbone in pain therapy back in the institute, along with Dr. Abhishek Srivastav. We have a backup of the gynecology department, the pathology department, the anesthesia department, the entire backup of the entire hospital, and colleagues who pick up these cases around. Now on the left, you found the entire backbone of the entire industry called the team department of urology. So the experience that each of us have in this audience today, which is across the world, I can see from European nations and from Gulf countries, and also from African countries. Thank you for logging in. Just now, we are talking about ICE bladder pain syndrome in a set of patients who go through agony and pregnancy. So experience, the evidence that exists and the expectation of these individuals is getting bigger and bigger, also in Google world, and we need to help our patients and all the Google patients to get well and get better. I look at this line with a pinch of salt, with the ordinance being passed 3 days, 3 nights ago in the parliament. We're looking forward to going all out to help our patients better. We also attempt to match expectation of these patients. And we look at sometimes we don't match the expectation. But looking at the expectation and looking at our own timelines, we follow the Hippocratic Oath, and that's how doctors think for the entire society, the world, their own families, their mother team, including the social distancing that we maintain. In COVID times, I've made a point that in all the seminars and webinars, I make it a point that my fingers and hands are busy on the console down here so that I don't bring it back to the facial parts and carry contagions out there. So we're looking at proudly the place and institute where we work in, and I built up a department and a multifactorial, multifaceted department which could do a multimodal therapy on this disease. And right from the days of commencement in 2009 to where we stand today, consolidated as a team for various subjects, which include robotic urology, reconstructive urology, pediatric urology, and adolescent urology. The subject of IC bladder pain syndrome transgresses genders and transgresses age groups around. Therefore, the year of distinction or decade of distinction, which put us back to where we belong to, is only because IC bladder pain syndrome back in this building and the society and with colleagues in Mumbai, gynecologists, pain therapists, intensivists, everything. It looked like we were a team and we had arrived. We had arrived in this whole world right now and country by looking at respecting duly the patient who come and obviously come with a lot of despair and agony. They don't carry an incidental ultrasound report or a urine routine report. They carry with themselves that burden of months, years, or decades of agony and treatment attempted, which may not have helped them to the point that they look at. So I think there's always a teamwork in this subject and many more, and therefore we is stronger than I is all that everybody preaches here. It dates back to historical origins of the subject, which means we are looking at Parsons and Parsons giving us this important topic in 2004 back in our Guru Granth Sahib, our Journal of Urology, where this article was published, and it was talking about Philip Singh Physique in 1808, who looked at an inflammatory condition of the bladder producing the same lower tract symptoms as if it's a bladder stone. So imagine what happens to a bladder stone. The stone in the bladder is all about discomfort, pain, dysuria, and one wants to empty it and cannot. And we go in and do a laser cystolithotripsy. Till that work went on from 1808 to 1836, Philip Singh Physique had expanded the entire concept to include those things which are now a part of the definition protocol that we follow as a country code. So it was all about a chronic frequency, urgency, and pain syndrome occurring in the absence of any demonstrable etiology. So it was not a bladder stone. It was akin to a possibility of a bladder stone giving all the symptoms, but actually it was chronic frequency, urgency, and pain syndrome in his 1808, where he formulated it to 1836 as hard work for these many years. Therefore, it looks like this, the earliest definitions till today talk about bladder inflammation and bladder inflammation of a kind where common features have undergone a change. In 100 years since what has happened till now where we sit in, the terms have bounced up and down, and there has been discussions about interstitial cystitis, painful bladder syndrome, hypersensitive bladder from the Asian group, chronic pelvic pain syndrome, which is a larger group that encompasses this. And then the International Continence Society came up with IC bladder pain syndrome. And then finally the ESIC, which brought about the BPS. So interchangeably, because these two belong to the larger domain, it is called as IC bladder pain syndrome. And I'm sure this will still undergo a change. We are at the point in evolution rather than completely evolved on the subject of. So what's new today that we're talking this, and I thank you colleagues on a Sunday afternoon. The subject is not new. The subject has got a lot of evidence and interest is evolving. Partly because what we cannot do, we pass it to our colleagues who can do better. Or what we cannot do, we encompass and form a teamwork, and that is how we move forward. The audience are my colleagues from the fraternity, and obviously audience beyond this, obviously invisible, are those target group, the patients who actually go from pillar to post, searching for relief, city to city, country to country. Therefore, treatment which has actually meandered between various aspects of the entire disease. Unfortunately, no new medicines which would come in, but the tiers of treatment have been defined. That's what AUA did for us in 2014. So the evidence is getting more concise and more teams and more groups are being formed. You, me, and everybody at this point in time in this country and the world on this subject are looking at innovation. That means innovation could help us, and innovation is basically a teamwork because I alone cannot do much, and all these I's are actually combining to form those needs. So if you all miss the boat in that era where many patients did suffer, and they did suffer, there was always a vision for today and tomorrow. There was to be in touch with times as the evidence became strongest and the evidence had become good, right? We wanted to create forums of national and international kind. And the one we created 5 years ago from the platform in India is for all of you to see, which is called as GIBS, or Global Institute of Cystitis Bladder Pain Society. The multidisciplinary team of urologists and gynecologists and general practitioners in each city combined together, form a national registry and support group of patients. And finally, each of us in this subject could make a small difference. Each of these drops could make a difference. And that's what happened 5 years ago when 15 of us combined together from various subsets of pain therapy, of gynecology, of pathology, of urology, and made it happen. So it's all about doing things differently, because what we did alone possibly did not give us those results in that era, or the results were still quite moderate. So about the ideas that we had around, when we combined together, the ideas became bigger and they translated into results which were more permanent, looking at from treatment to a cure level. That means these ideas did change us and change our patients. And therefore, having these ideas which were easy, but to implement them alone was not possible, we implemented that in a teamwork. Our only block at any point in time was the confidence that we could do it alone to a patient who is going through so much on various aspects of the disease. Therefore, the confidence when built up and inertia went off, because the past results were not what we were geared up around. The presentation today is to create your own working team, which you always have. You already have it. It is about creating your own working principles based on the guidelines that are available in the world, and then to move on in the subject to get more people, better result, and to make them forget that 2020 was actually a year of agony for mankind. I must salute here my colleagues in gynecology practice, because gynecologists, maybe 50,000 gynecologists in India compared to 5,000 urologists in the country, we get outnumbered, but we know that we only see a tip of the iceberg. That means a woman who suffers more frequently in IC bladder pain syndrome goes more frequently to the masters and practitioners of pelvic health or perineal health, which are gynecologists. That means for all gynecologists in the audience today, and for all gynecologists who actually stood by for this subject and given us those thumping hand in helping us out to take the subject forward, the session belongs to each of you. It's to give you back the subject because it belongs to you since the day it was born for the first time. Leroy Hunter, who himself was a gynecologist, had described this entity, and the very ulcer, which is called a lesion today, was described by Leroy Hunter. To me, this is a great movement and a point where we are able to come back to you as all the gynecologists in the city, country, and to so many gynecologists logged in around today, including pain therapists. I'm impressed that you looked at the Twitter world and you came in around at very odd hours in your country to be able to log in today. But this is for many students, many evolving urologists and gynecologists who form their teamwork around that nobody is over the guidelines at this point. That means when we look at the subject, we look at 2016, and we look at the gynecologist had already created a guidelines from the RCOG. The RCOG guidelines came in 2016, December. That's the time we had actually floated our GIPS forum, and we were moving quite strongly around at that point in time. So 2016, for the time when we had evolved ourselves in India, we had actually got into the large subject of forming our own teams in various cities, various states, and creating a global forum that would actually be launched, which our Urology Society of India gave us a big platform on this UCCon at Kochi. And thank you so much, Dinesh, that happy. So we looked at 2017 and got our best clinical practices. We never actually made it look like a pure guidelines because we had looked at the entire world. At GIPS, 15 of us sat across the round tables back to and forth in 16 and 17. I looked at how to get the best clinical practices, which we label as the GIPS clinical guidelines, which were the best from the working principles. I looked at what could be changing or evolving in this subject, which I will come to you in a single slide a little later in the presentation. So this is very much available at the website of the GIBSSociety.org. We actually go in, become a member, wait for our next Congress, which comes in September. We have fixed up a date as 5th September, and we will have an internal meet, and we'll come back to you on that. And many more practitioners of the art would actually join Who have actually logged in. A huge number of logins today is all about wake up call for the September month, where we're coming in with a bigger and multiple whole scenarios to cover, and you will have the best of the speakers who would actually talk, take this subject forward, and we have them in India and abroad. So just taking you through what patients say, what the evidence says, and what we need to do today to make our happening around. Let's look at a young lady. She's young, she's only 39. And what has she been treated with? She's been treated in that past era when they missed the boat as a case of recurrent urinary tract infection. She has pain, and pain could be burning pain, discomfort, pressure. All that she describes is in the lower abdomen. The lower abdomen takes the brunt of it. She has got discomfort going down into the perineum, along the urethra and the vulva, along the introitus. She has got some relief when she empties her bladder. So this does not happen in an overactive bladder. This does not happen in urinary tract infection. So just trying to break this entity quickly free and away from those subjects which are also of great importance and where women suffer, where young women suffer, and we don't find much of the causes, and we continue working on them. So here we are with a set of complaints where pain in the lower abdomen, urethra, and the vulva, which is relieved partly by warding. And she has got intermittent episodes of complete silence. That means there are times when she is completely silent and covered. She narrates her own aggravating factors. Aggravating factors are umpteen, including her psychosomatic factors, but she is unable to be sexually active. She's too young. Sexual engagement causes an intense pain deep inside. She was completely free for approximately 14 months. That's what her history book says around during and after her second pregnancy. So during her second pregnancy, which is all about the first pregnancy, never had all this, or before that, she very clearly remembers that I was completely free. I never required a doctor, never had a complaint to talk to anybody. Now she presents with burning maturation, aggravated symptoms of all the above. That means 14 months after her second pregnancy, at some point in time, she wakes up to a phenomena which is not helping her out. And she doesn't remember, doesn't forget, sorry, about her past of recurrent UTI, which was possibly not the right diagnosis, or recurrent UTI may be an aggravating factor of the multiple aggravating factors that she had. The flare-up is what we describe in the disease, comes up with multiple factors that we discussed today, and this was one of them, which is vocal. So her childhood was not free from symptoms too, but they were different. Childhood symptoms in school days could be more of frequency, urgency, and not being able to fool around. We look at what you would like to know at this point in time are the aggravating factors. And aggravating factors here could be anything, which I will come back later. It could be her food habits, it could be her social habits, it could be a UTI that worsens, it could be a sexual activity. So there could be multiple aggravating factors that a patient could have at home. So it could be systemic factors, it could be psychosomatic and social factors. The pain that she talks about, the location that she talks about, and the radiation he talks about has almost not much resolution, except it dies down to a level around when she empties the bladder. She obviously is her own medication given by her doctors, her colleague urologists, and gynecologists. So we look at her as a homemaker. That means she's not working as a nurse or as a banker, but she's working as a homemaker and obviously can't give up her job. She needs to continue adjustments and waiting for family to come back home and huddle. In this era today, social distancing, sitting across and playing the Ludo on the Ludo King, but continues to have discomfort, goes in very quickly and passes urine. And so like I say, I'm a little better. Can I just skip away? So she has got a GI symptoms, the genitourinary symptoms, and her past always rings back. She also has deep dyspareunia. So there are suspicions in her above history that she has got discomfort on physical and on food and on various aspects that she goes through. I want to add a slide here talking about clinical examination gives all, and none of these patients are without clinical examination. That means their history and their evaluation is more by talking and letting them talk as much as they can. So that gives us a lot of idea about what they go through. But gynecology colleagues who are actually looking at this presentation and who are a part of the entire work always look at more deeply than us because they examine, they look at every aspect of it. So if we are in a suprapubic tenderness, look at something without a UTI, we look at the bladder is uncomfortable. You press the bladder on deep palpation, there's a pain. Many of these patients do have. And they actually press and tell that there is a pain. But well, let's look at a gynecological examination where just a Q-tip test, just a minimal touch on the vulva, it gives a pain. Is it more neuralgic? It's more of a vulvodynia compared to a perivaginal examination. Whereas the finger enters the vestibule or the introitus, there's a discomfort of a painful kind which cannot go. This is not dyspareunia, or this is not something like vaginismus, but just a vestibulitis, which was never there before. Compared to a deep examination, which is all about you having your finger inside and examining well the introitus all the way deep into the fornices, look at an anterior tenderness. The anterior tenderness alone, which is the region of the bladder up there in the examination, the trigone and the posterior bladder wall, gives you to suspect that is this lady right? Could she be having all that, which was in her history at age of 39, that she could be having a possible bladder pain syndrome? So we're looking at the entire gamut of believing the patient for the first time and always, because we get to know a lot from history. We answer her only when we look at it. We will do what we do best under Hippocratic Oath. We look forward to doing an evaluation for her. We reassure her and say that even if reports come good or bad, you will be treated forever. So whatever is your past is gone forever. We do urine routine evaluation, do good urine culture. And remember, for all my colleagues in practice who actually are busy practitioners of the art, we always tell them do a proper cleaned up midstream clean catch specimen without necessarily an early morning specimen. The bottom line, in all these lower tract symptoms is a warning diary, and we look at warning diary with a pinch of salt. It gives us a lot of objective and subjective measurements as we move forward in the journey from medical management and various behavioral therapies to minimally invasive therapies to look at will we have we met a match of an end stage plan. And if possible, we should know how is she living her life, and the best way is to look at a uroflowmetry. Metry measurement, flow speed, and urine is urine. So uroflowmetry tells us all that she does in the washroom, which we cannot look at even at the camp time. So it gives us all about her voiding idea. And that basics take us forward to the next step. So for those who wanted to know the answers, the urine routine and culture is negative. But this time she doesn't have a record. The eye phenomena she has aggravated, and she wakes up and comes to you as a gynecologist, urogynecologist, or a urologist and says, I have a discomfort which is akin to what it was not there in that 14 months around. A frequency volume chart has changed, and it looks like that she has kept a good frequency volume chart of what she drinks, what time she passes urine, and looks like 16 to 5 is an average that she looks like. And uroflowmetry, obviously, sadly, is a low volume kind of a situation where a low volume flow every time because she's that frequent, a forced frequency that she cannot handle, and on all attempts, you find her low volume frequency continues. So it's a bell-shaped curve with a terminal straining. The terminal straining is a learned behavior that she has. In other words, to be able to empty her bladder on the last part, else she may have to go again in 10 minutes or half an hour. A post-flow residue at the end of this low volume bell-shaped curve with a terminal straining that she spends still 1-3 minutes on the voiding is 20 ml. And we decide with all these symptoms around that she never undergone a cystoscopy, take a telescope in. So while a big debate is raging at this point in the ICBPS world about looking at how to evaluate a patient up the ladder faster or lesser, remember, most of these patients go through the trauma of actually having gone through it. Just looking at one of the ladies around, we're looking at cystoscopic finding with the lady. Lo and behold, up there on the right posterior lateral, you see something. You saw a quick ulcer, a kind of a fixture or kind of a lesion that hits your head, and there's another one there. So we look at there's something abnormal out there. I wish I could annotate that, but I will move my cursor and show you what is what. So those are the air bubbles, and that's a dome. Finger is pressing the bladder, and these cystoscopies in these patients are always under general anesthesia. With the consent that we may take it forward by other therapies that is required around, you can see that central part which looks like a lesion. That doesn't look normal mucosa. This is a real-time cystoscopy done by us, done by anybody, and this has nothing edited up there. You can see something just went up out there, was also again not normal. So we'll come back to all that. We are playing this cystoscopy. Look at the anterior bladder wall shows a tear. Oh, the anterior bladder shows as if there's tearing across. You can see that the anterior bladder wall is showing a tear here and is just 25 seconds into cystoscopy in a woman who is suffering this for a long time. So while the bladder is almost showing mucosal tears, which are linear, and we are not being slow on the cystoscopy, this is a real-time movement, somebody helping us out with moving the scope as fast as possible. And he says, sir, I don't find a lesion. I don't find a bladder growth. I don't find a stone. And her flow is poor. She could be something else. And while we're looking at all that, I said, we just persist with the cystoscopy for a short while. We assess her bladder capacity. And we're looking at all that. The bladder capacity will come a little later, but we look at that the bladder wall anteriorly is getting across. Mucosa undergoes a tear. So we are corroborating not with the cystoscopy, but with all that she has in the history is actually coming. Let's continue looking at the cystoscopy for maybe one more minute because it's a real-time, non-edited cystoscopy. And, you know, somebody who finds nothing on a cystoscopy big enough, trigger-happy, but actually continue looking at all the sides that she has got a complaint. So that's a real-time cystoscopy going on. Now, I wish I could have been interactive, but the modus operandi doesn't allow us to be interactive. Looking at this lady, things are changing already while we talk. The bladder mucosa looked very good if I just continue interacting. It looked very good when we started. And suddenly you find things are changing in a real-time cystoscope. You're looking at global glomerulations coming up all around. You're looking at anterior bladder wall mucosa showing tear already. You find some areas which are patchy and there is surrounding cross-vascularity, which you can now see. A great amount of vessels and angiogenesis. And that's what the new talk on folate metabolism talks about, that these mucosa have got increased vascularity of a different kind, not necessarily the normal vascularity. And let's come back to the anterior bladder wall. And lo and behold, you already toned the bladder mucosa in last 1.5 or 2 minutes of cystoscopy. You can see those are bladder tears and bladder mucosa. We're coming back to the right side. I'm coming back to the end of cystoscopy, and as I move in and out, I look at that there is more than meets the eye. This patient must be suffering, must be going through her agony because she cannot fill her bladder. That we have given her anesthesia, and we have been able to fill her bladder to whatever levels we could fill. Look like a moderate bladder capacity to you too. There's not a completely gone bladder, but you can see this is a blood dance. This is all life. You can see the blood dance happening from the dome, and this is global. This is not just one. A classical case where you found some ulcerated areas, you will soon in next 3 seconds not be able to see anything because it's all pouring from the sky and it's everything. So you saw those ulcerations which we did not pinpoint too long, and you saw that the entire thing is blood. If this is what a bladder when challenged looks like, it surely goes through an agony around. So friends, we looked at 39 years young lady going through an agony of being in trouble times where we are not able to get her more till we find the reality. So this entire trigger of a cystoscopic finding or to do a cystoscopy or not is being shared by our forum, and we're looking at cystoscopy is an investigation which is done under general anesthesia to be done in time. And I will dwell a little bit about how cystoscopy is so important by you as urogynecologist, by you as urologist, and by colleagues across who practice IC bladder pain syndrome, because at the bottom of it or at the crux of it is sadly the bladder. So let's not forget that these patients sometimes sadly get mismanaged because they don't know what to complain, whom to complain to, when to come, and they always come late. Nobody comes on the day there was a fever. They always come in number of days, months, years, or decades after they had discomfort. So we're just moving forward to another patient now, a male patient. We talked about it's more preponderant in females, but males do suffer too. The chronology of event in males could be a little different because they have got organ systems which are dealt with a little differently. They also have got organs where may have in terminology missed out, like the urethral syndrome disappearing from the Campbell's urology, and like a urethral chill disappeared from the Campbell's urology in the new 12th edition of Campbell. I look forward to many subjects are going in upheaval and change, while some subjects become as strong as this, which is discussed on a Sunday afternoon. Looking at 2014, when this 54 years young male then had progressive lower urinary tract symptom and burning micturition. So he had everything progressive. He had gross frequency. In fact, he had fourth frequency. He was not able to. So he was looking to anybody else, a overactive bladder kind of a picture where day and night he's attempting to go and pass urine. Obviously, his flow may not have been good, and therefore there was a failed combination therapy attempted by his doctors, which was a combination of alpha blockers and anticoagulants. So imagine a young man in his prime of life has done well in his life and subject and a settled family, settled and workplace too. And looking at the next 6 years, will take a retirement and go fishing, actually finds his quality of life getting worse. Getting worse with every passing day, month, and year. He sees the best of the team around in the city where he lived and worked in, and he was treated. He was evaluated and treated, and they looked at, nothing was happening much while he was worsening. So he was evaluated outside and treated for all that. In 2015, his treatment continued and he underwent a uroflowmetry, which was a baseline uroflowmetry pattern. This is how his records and his charts show. So he had in 2015, in another place perhaps, underwent a uroflowmetry, which was again being given at some point, but he had a progressive pattern altogether. Remember, he was an alpha blocker. So if I take the history forward, the colleague and the teams were looking at giving him a good flow and also giving him a quality of life of not having cross frequency and forced frequency. The uroflowmetry a year later is documented as baseline uroflowmetry with straining patterns, which as sad story. So cystoscopy was done under local anesthesia just to look at what is happening in this young man who's now 55 years. And they found a grade one prostate. They found a steep bladder neck. They found the bladder of adequate capacity. No major erythema or no calculi. So he was possibly somewhere focusing, not focusing, but he was not happy with himself. His Euroflowmetry spoke all. Obstructed, frequent. So it was obviously labeled as a secondary overactive bladder, with the bladder looking acceptable and the prostate showing that kind of a situation where a young man could possibly get a bladder neck incision. So he underwent a TURP BNI 3 months later. 3 months were still waited for the medical management by the team which was taking care of him as the records go and as his OP files get picked up. He continued to have symptoms of gross urgency, precipitancy, and urge incontinence after a BNI. Not uncommon. As a urologist, we sometimes see that the refractory symptoms of overactive bladder or the storage symptoms don't disappear very quickly. They stay for a long time. And therefore, he was given anticholinergics and he became refractory to anticholinergics there. So that means his anticholinergics did not work. He was uncomfortable. That was the era when we were dealing with a single drug therapy, or the drug therapy which we had was anticholinergics. So 2015, from the beginning when he has a poor flow after days, months or years of trouble in 2000 till 2014, many got documented. At 2015, he underwent from an evaluation by local and under local anesthesia to finally a learned team did a cystoscopy, bladder neck incision, gave him a flow. His urgency, frequency, precipitancy continued to happen. He wasn't happy with himself. He had got his flow, but he's not happy with himself. So no medicines worked for him. Let's move forward. 2016, he had continued symptoms. He had pain in the pelvis. See, from frequency, urgency, urge incontinence, we are moving forward. Is there a change in the paradigm shift of this disease? So he had a pain in pelvis and he would say that I used to travel, Dr. Pandey, with my bike, which could race up and down this Western Express Highway. The bumpy roads in this monsoon season doesn't give me a good ride. Because I have got deep pain when I go through this lumpy, bumpy roads that's existing right now in our country. So he got into a limited and restricted lifestyle only in the age of 56. Cross urgency frequency, pain and discomfort happening, and probably a disease which was that stable up there and was going a downhill course completely. So he was not in diapers, obviously, but with all this, he may have seen a new team, and the new records showed that he underwent a cystoscopy and a refractory overactive bladder symptoms and background of no obstruction. He underwent a botulinum toxin, 100 international units, rightly enough, under general anesthesia. At that point in time, team talks about a small anesthetic bladder capacity. They talk about the needle resistance to an intradetrusal location. These have been mentioned in the notes of a learned colleague who actually did the wonderful job of giving him relief from his refractory urgency frequency around. So this happened around, he got some relief, but his symptoms again exacerbated. So he was not improving upon himself, and while he was being given the best of the treatment by the teams which took care of him under the evidence that was available, the symptoms went on improving, worsening. That's roller coaster, right? Finally landed up with such exacerbated symptoms that they catheterized him. He was not happy with the catheter either. So he was very uncomfortable with the catheter, and he was just a very young male. So we're looking at 2016. So what was left over in 2018 were options that were left over. That's the time he underwent a cystoscopy. I have possibly a cystoscopy video which you'll play. Yeah. So sitting in the prostatic urethra, which has undergone a TURP. You can look at, there's a, the cavity is good enough, the prostatic fossa, and the large telescope 22 French walks in easily into the urinary. This patient is undergoing a cystoscopy on general anesthesia. The recording is very amateur. You can make out that there is no editing here too. It's being probably by one of our colleagues being picked up from the screen itself. Yes, from the screen itself. Look at this, and this does not look normal bladder in a 56-year-old. It's suffering. It's undergone a botulinum toxin injection in 2016. 2017 was all for continuing to suffer. Sorry, 2017 and then in 2018. End is when he undergoes a cystoscopy. So there he is. The bladder does not look normal. That's the dome of the bladder. You saw the air bubble there. And the bladder capacity is, on this documentation, around 245 ml. This is a general anesthesia. You can find a global erythema here. I'm not sure how to look at it. But find a global erythema. You also look at some areas which are looking. So that is a central zone which looks like, I would not say lesion or ulcer, but I would look at a parchment area with surrounding vascularity. Maybe the screen transmissions from the screen to my screen to your screen look a little different. We find there are areas which are not of normal vascularity. There are areas which are patchy, areas which are of hyperemia. Look at that now. Yes. So you can look at these and get to understand that these areas are not normal. The patient complains in his own language, best understood by him and us. But we look at this bladder cries every day. It cries of discomfort, pain, urgency, frequency. And there's something which could be a male or a female bladder. They would undergo their therapies with the best of team under evidence. Again, this is an unedited video directly from the screen. Obviously, you can look at the amateurish video recording which has happened around because we are cutting down screens. But you only necessarily see that this bladder is not normal. 240, 250 ml is a bladder capacity mentioned after the scopy is over. And these kind of patients undergo a cystoscopy. So you can look at that. The dome is very close. The anterior wall is very close to the bladder. The entire erythema is not looking very, very good. The vascularity and the supply. And therefore, yeah, that's a Hanner's lesion. You can see that. A lesion with central ulceration and surrounding. That's a classical description of what we talk around. So this man has evolved. He's evolved to all he happened till 2014 and from 14 to 15 to 16 to 18 and now 19. This is what happened to him. So while we look at his cystoscopy and we have done approximately a minute of cystoscopy, looked at all the walls, we looked at least two of these areas, at least two, even more, which had classical Hanner's lesion with surrounding erythema. If you attempt to fill a 240 ml bladder capacity more than that, this is what happens around. That means he cannot hold his bladder. He can hold his bladder now because he's under general anesthesia and be able to look at a possibility of hydrodistension, which we are doing not right now. But the bladder is being deflated. As you deflate the bladder, you find everything turning red and the teen is not able to have a look at it. So you saw two live cases of the age of 39 and the age of at the age of 39, age of 54, who actually went through trouble and who went through the agony of a progressive disease. Which disease in the world other than this? It's not like urosepsis where somebody has problem in the morning and by evening he's on ventilator and death. The gram-negative bacteria killed him completely. Compared to a disease where the agony and progression is so slow that it beats the medical science completely and colleagues in hierarchy, looking at not being able to identify the disease because nothing is visible. What is visible is patient's complaints and history. And for every complaint, we don't do a cystoscopy. So a patient has been suffering for long term on this disease. We got to wake up and possibly help these patients faster. So the evaluation algorithm is again more of a teamwork, more of working principles and more of understanding. And we're not finished our examples yet. I said, what patients say, those patients said two different stories. 39 years, young lady, a homemaker who can't give her habit of homemaking, can actually now not sit on a Ludo board and play Ludo, but play Ludo King and keep in the washroom n number of times, continues to live in agony till we do a cystoscopy and find what a bladder. There was a blood dance all the way from the roof in those 2.14 minutes or 2 minutes and 14 seconds of cystoscopy where the bladder was filled with 60 centimeters of water. That was sad. So she doesn't have a massive bladder capacity and the inner lining has completely given way. That means if the inner lining of her mouth gives way, then even water and sweet all will taste the same, pain and burning, etc. So my inner lining or lining, which is so important, the lining gone wrong. Everything is all about pancystitis. We're looking at some more patients and we're looking at a women preponderant disease. We look at a lot of men coming and complaining. We miss them out many a times in between stricture urethras and prostatomegalies and prostatitis and chronic pelvic pain syndrome. And I wish and pray that as the urology circles and teachers and thought makers look at this subject, the bigger subject, look at actually tailoring it down and helping us out to find these patients much earlier and their sequence and series of problems. But women have got it right because their organ systems are lesser and less frequent. They have got overlapping diseases on the pelvis with uterus and ovaries. But let's look at somebody whom we will see tomorrow morning. So she is 50, she is 44 years journalist. She's from Rajkot, a city which I visit once a month, which I used to visit. And what she complains of is gross frequency of urination. Gross frequency. Doc, I have gross frequency both day and night. It's just not frequency, one of the components of overactive bladder, but she also has got burning sensations in the lower zone. That's what she says. She's a learned lady. She's 44 and journalist. Maybe covering this whole item, I don't know. So lower zone, that whole area that she complains of, lower zone. And she says, I have dyspareunia, let me confess. But I've got regular menstrual periods. I've seen my gynecologist because we women go to our gynecologist first, and that's where I rate them very strongly, that they're able to confess, they're able to confide, they're able to tell their question and answers. And as gynecologists and urologists are always partners in the pelvis and need each other and work with each other, we get to know the history much better from gynecologist, more so from patients too. So she was treated as recurrent UTI because her urine sample showed bacteria over the past 2 years with your colleagues, and she had no relief. So if somebody had no relief and she was as young as 44 and premenopausal, wasn't that we're missing a boat? Wasn't something wrong in this patient? Maybe as gynecologist, you could look at endometriosis or something else or chronic pelvic pain syndrome. But anyway, she's coming tomorrow, Monday morning, to see you in a semi-emergency. That means she continues to have sensations which are uncomfortable. Sensations, there are no sensations in my nails and in my hair. Otherwise, I would be so uncomfortable. But sensations happening in the lower zone, which is all about multiple organs, giving you discomfort, urination, pain, etc. It's quite tough. And she is a lady who wants to see you tomorrow. Let's move to the next case. 29 years young female from the capital city of the country. She's single and she's a cinematographer. Welcome, Ms. K. Now, she goes complaining about gross learned frequency and a forced frequency. She learned this frequency partly because she would not be able to hold urine, and that was her reality. A learned and a forced frequency for the last 3 years. That's fine, but it's progressive. It hasn't stopped yet. That means there's a progression happening in this disease per se. Looking at how she goes and manages herself, frequency volume charts everything around. She talks about the forced by a lower abdominal discomfort, has to visit the water closet at least 20 times in the daytime. So 20 times in the daytime, out of the awake 16 hours that she has, she goes 20 times. So at least more than once in an hour. That's how it is. She wakes up at night. You and I also wake up at night, but she wakes up at night a few times to pass urine with discomfort. Nobody in this august audience across the world, and nobody ever in overactive bladder, wakes up at night with pain, with discomfort, with pressure in the lower abdomen. So are we waking up to an individual who's young and who actually lands up with a pain, pressure, or discomfort in the lower abdomen, which wakes her up? It's not an alarm bell or a partner or a dog barking outside which wakes her up. It's her own inner awareness of not being able to. So in the deepest of the sleep, which she gets for a few hours before she wakes up, and what does she do? She passes small amounts. She needs to see a gynecologist whom she sees because she has got gross irregular periods, a PCOD, and she will get corrected. We all know very well. Her urine routine and cultures are normal. She has no recurrent EPI. She has no overactive bladder. She has got that discomfort. She has learned it. If I want to go to the washroom 100 times a day, then I have learned to go it because there's a reason to go. If I'm thirsty, I will drink water. I will not eat. If I'm hungry, I will eat and I will not drink. So I think human beings are very, very capable in terms of giving the complaints when they come to doctors around. And it quite behoves us as, and from the medical community point of view, that we are a learned people. We are looking at climbing on the science of this subject and many subjects as teams, as individuals. We also do our own internal research and look at research from other locations and countries. We move forward and understand that these patients tell the truth. They go through the agony. Many a times it looks like that many of these patients go through the agony of different kind. I'll come to it just a shade later. Let's move forward to the capital city of Ahmedabad, and we have Mrs. L. Yes, Mrs. L is 54 and again a housemaker, yes. And she has burning sensation in the lower part. She has burning sensation in the introitus. She's postmenopausal and she has pain on full bladder. She says, "Doc, when my bladder is full, please excuse me. I don't want to do anything else but go and pass you." She also tells that, "I don't travel in rickshaws and lumpy, bumpy roads around because traveling in rickshaw gives me more discomfort." That means when you do a pervaginal examination and look at the anterior bladder wall, and you press that introitus up there, the ventrovaginal wall, the trigone and the anterior bladder wall there, there's a pain or discomfort or tenderness you pick up. That's the kind of pain tenderness comes up, you know, lumpy, bumpy. That's what you have, a supraoccipital discomfort when you examine her. I think it's all coming from different directions, and we're waking up to it that women go through this discomfort silently. As women in the society, at least in conservative countries and societies, that they probably don't speak on the Twitter and speak everywhere around. So they describe a painful urgency like she described. This urgency, which is painful. An urgency where I would run, go and pass urine, is more of an overactive bladder. But urgency, which is painful, could be also a urinary tract infection. But we're talking of people who are suffering for months and years and even decades around. She gave up. She gave up sexual activity because of all this, because it's all painful. Because it was also confusing, she was evaluated by a gynecologist and there was nothing visible on any imaging study, on any evaluation study. And it was giving her a picture of her endometriosis because there were other hormone profile changes and other markers which the gynecologist picked up around, and she was a learned gynecologist. So she has not got a relief, and therefore she wants to shift over and change and see one of the urogynecologists back in your city around. Let's complete what students say by the last case and the youngest case in the scenario. She's just 22. She is Miss A and 22, she's a student. She's from the city of Kochi and she presented with a urinary tract infection. So she came with UTI. And we discussed UTI in women is all about burning sensations. She was febrile UTI, prayers that she was not ascending into pyelonephritis. She had urgency and she had even hematuria. So bad urinary tract infection that she remembers. Remember, this was 4 years ago postcoital. She remembers it. She remembers very well that, "Doc, it was all burning sensation, discomfort. I got the symptomatic therapy. I got the antibiotics. I got cured. But, you know, in this UTI, which was so bad, I got hematuria and urgency and even fever." But it's very, very sad of a young woman. And women have made such that the urinary tract close to the vagina and the rectum is always soiled in the introitus with bacteria and UTI is not very uncommon phenomena. That's where we ask them to give a clean CAT specimen, pick up the things even in the exacerbative period to prove that it's not UTI which is causing it. That's a part of the evaluation process. We look at it. So since then, since she remembers 4 years ago in 2016, we're sitting in 2020, a year which a lot of us want to forget forever because of the COVID. Pelvis is on fire. She complains that my menstrual periods always have been haywire, doc. My coitus is uncomfortable. I void day and night, I'm not sure what, but my pre-micturation, that means before my bladder fills up, I've got pelvic abdominal pain radiating everywhere down there, which is all about a discomfort that she goes to. So she comes tomorrow, 27th of April, 2020, to one of your clinics at 11 a.m. because you start a late OPD these days and a very curtained OPD. Maybe she may consult you on a Skype. And she'll tell you all that agony. Sometimes it may be painful to hear, but finally at the end of it, she deserves treatment. And we look at, these are very young patients. My colleague from New York told me that in New York City, in that era, which was peacetime and not the wartime that we're going through, a patient in 20s to 60s will arrive to his clinic, and he works in the New York City Central. He talks about looking at this subject with a lot of pinch of salt. He said that he patient would see at least 9 doctors in and around the city and the countryside and locations in healthcare before they would come and see him. So he was not intrigued about it. He just gave me an idea. I said, this is not uncommon even in our country and countries of the world. All the countries and the countries which watch us today, I can see Scandinavia, I can see African countries, I can see Gulf countries lined up today. I can see our students lined up today and my colleagues in urology who have picked up this subject as a part of their domain that they will take up forward because they do female urology or they do functional urology. It is all about looking at the complaints that these patients have. So while they complain of pain, pressure, heaviness, urinary symptoms and all, and the patients and relatives go from session to session and move from city to city and clinician to clinician, up in the hierarchy, the husband gets tired and says, Doc, can I ask you a question? Does she have a psychological disease? So you look up and say, oh, that's something which is very sad. Because he has been partnering her and helping her for last 3, 5, 7 years, moving with her and giving her all the respect that she deserves and all the treatment that she deserves around, obviously. At the same time, nothing has been picked up. Remember, nothing has been picked up. Nothing was picked up. There were some menstrual changes, and in case 3, somebody was treated for endometriosis because there were doubts in that direction. Again, that was a disease of border exclusion. And out here, ultrasound kar liya, CT kar liya, sab kuch kar liya, but we're not getting any disease, doc. The urine cultures are negative, but she complains. It's something wrong in her head. It's something psychological. So imagine so much of psychosomatic things happen around. The patients go through a trauma of a stress that they have a disease which not even the partner can understand. Forget the doctors whom they would meet for a 10 to 20 or 30 minutes of consult. So we sit at a threshold of understanding many subjects where a patient may not complain. A patient doesn't complain of things which you pick up on the ultrasound, which you pick up on the health checkup. They never complain. They came for a checkup and they picked up something. Out here, a patient complains and complains and complains, and we sometimes forget to probably look at between the lines on the subject and text. So these complaints are private to the entire subject. And that's where, when we woke up 5 years ago to create GibbsSociety.org for the Gibbs Society with 15 of us from multiple departments to treat this multifactorial disease with multidisciplinary treatment on a multimodal therapy, I think we today, 5 years later in India and globe, stand very tall. Kudos and hats off to everybody who has been a part of the Gibbs network, Gibbs teamwork, and the team which has actually at the back office helped us to move forward. So looking at pain and discomfort, as I told you, the husband and the partner and previous doctors say, Doc, I'm referring your case, which I don't understand much, but she talks about pain, discomfort, burning, etc. So are pain and discomfort the same? Is there a burning pain or a pain where you have got a burning neuralgic kind of discomfort? What are the terms which various, a patient coming from Bengal or a patient coming from Tamil Nadu would tell and I would understand? And how do they see that the pain is coming from the bladder? That means a patient understands her body well. They know which are the organs as to where it is felt around. And they would say things are fine. And as I said, the pain distribution is just not in the bladder. There is always a crosstalk, which is a part of the huge science that we look at when we look at pain and central sensitization. We look at our colleagues in various subjects who look at the subject more globally, that there is pain in the lower abdomen. That's where the bladder is. And then the pain is radiating everywhere around in that area, and we hardly believe it. So it's all about discomfort, and that's where our physiatrist, pain therapist, back Navita, thank you so much for looking at evaluating each pain mentally and physically and looking at giving them the relief before you even evaluate them. So looking at clinical examination, which Campbell's 12th edition of urology talks very tall. If you look at the Campbell's 12th edition of urology, which I read today late, in the morning before I look at this presentation. It's all about understanding the myofascial bands in both men and women. So always look at these myofascial bands to me. Sorry, I'm touching my hairs and not my face in the COVID era. I'm looking at being very safe for myself and everybody as we practice and preach. We're looking forward to the myofascial bands. The bands are all about identifying those bands which need to be loosened up, which need probably a pain injection, relaxation exercises, maybe an ultrasound therapy, maybe an injections, which Navita, you give. Many of these patients get the relief for a few months to longer weeks, and then they come back perhaps with a lesser amount of sensitivity altogether. So distribution of pain, and therefore, let's not forget that while as a gynecologist back in the audience, as a urologist, and we have got pain therapists and many more advocates of the subject in the audience today, pan country and pan world, we look forward to giving them the relief on this discomfort. While we give them a relief on the overactive component of the bladder, while we give them relief on the mental satisfaction that we can give them, we got to relieve their pain, which is the crux of the entire disease. It's a bladder pain syndrome. It's a pancystitis and crosstalks with various organs around. And the factor affecting pain are many. The micturition cycle itself is all about the bladder is too full and I cannot hold because this bladder's inner lining or the gag lining is getting destroyed. So imagine that's the bladder and the inner lining or the gag lining is getting destroyed, which means that if I put water in my mouth, I'll have pain. If I put sweet in my mouth, I'll still have burning and discomfort. So this just before passing urine, because I know when to pass, because my bladder is full, not that completely full, but full enough that it's giving me a discomfort. And the pain may be during the passage and then at the end of the passage too. And then we have got a pain when you compress my bladder or compress my lower abdomen. And then when somebody examines me as a gynecologist and puts a finger inside and examines me very well and finds no disease, I have got a deep sense of discomfort, which you call as tenderness up there, which could be superficial and deep dyspareunia. And it's all about the pain that I go through as a gynecologist. So these patients go through a dilemma, and I was talking about those four cases versus two cases who underwent therapy, see multiple doctors in the lifestyle. In New York, very clearly, we heard that they see nine doctors before they come and probably see the man who meets or the woman who meets them at. So years of suffering, some more than a decade, with unnecessary surgeries like the TURP and the botulinum toxin and the BNI, which happened in this patient, not that it was unnecessary. These were all with evidence of time, but we could not look between the lines as the patient was evolving. So medical community works completely on evidence and Hippocratic oath. And as urologists, we look at the evidence on the background of the continued complaints, which is not being managed medically. So refractory symptoms are looked forward by minimally invasive therapies, which we are trigger happy to operate around. Similarly, in gynecology, I hope you've heard that many patients underwent hysterectomy, which could be called as unnecessary, because after hysterectomy, all the symptoms get relieved. They still continue to have pain. Their DUB disappeared, but they had pain, they had discomfort. And therefore, many a times today, when we go back, we look at some of the surgeries may have been perhaps unnecessary. But then that is how we learn. We learn from our own mistakes. And that is why the era where we treated everybody as recurrent UTI, while the disease progressed and caused pancystitis, where we could have done a cystoscopy much earlier and could have teamed up, could have helped us out. So lack of objective evidence in many, and that's where husbands and partners and many doctors get lost at. There's no major evidence on ultrasound or on cystoscopy or on evaluation or void in diary. So what do we pick up around? So that's where we're dealing with this pelvis, a pelvis which is the home to many organs. Confusable diseases wake up and wake you around. Because of the loss of credibility that these patients have, they go through the trauma of being suspected, being suspect, lack of faith by own family members. They go through the psychosomatic issues and many of them say, you think, doctor, is there an end to it? You think that I'm seeing you, and many times you will hear a patient will tell you, you are my last hope. That means in diseases of this kind, where you have an anger enemy, something which you see pure from a psychoma, anger enemy, fear of death, you are my last hope. That means they have got thoughts which are close to suicide. So in that background, we're talking about this disease where Lovell Parsons and Graham Sand brought up definitions in those era of early days, where interstitial cystitis was treated as urgency, frequency, and pain in the absence of different etiology. No etiology overall was a single line, great definition, Lovell Parsons. We look at Granham Sant, who gave a definition which was encompassing a larger domain. We looked at the triad of urinary frequency, urgency, and bladder or pelvic pain in the absence of bacterial infection, so no UTI, or any other demonstrable or definable etiology, and that was the definition of IC. So that was the early days, looking at 60s, 70s, 80s, and working on that. But as we moved forward, as societies grew, as we understood more and we knew that our results of the past were not the best, bladder pain syndrome was defined by ESSIC as chronic pelvic pain, pressure, or discomfort perceived to be related to the urinary bladder, because the patient complains of that area, accompanied by at least one or more urinary symptoms of the storage kind, because the gag layer being absent, not replenished, The discomfort doesn't allow the patient to hold urine back. Therefore, persistent urge or increased frequency in the absence of any infection or any other pathology. And it then behoved that IC component was bladder pain syndrome, but typical cystoscopic or histological features, which means that we actually had arrived to a point in time where we're looking at creating domains and understanding the subject much better. I think we're still evolving. In 2020, we're evolving around, but at this point in time, the evidence what allows us is that a bladder pain syndrome is a large subset where you have crosstalk, where you have all the organs around. An IC could be a small subset of the atmosphere where you've got discomfort, you've got issues, and everything is related to possibly the finding that we pick up around if we do a cystoscopy and look at. So IC could be bordering anywhere in the large domain of bladder pain syndrome. If you look at the normal bladder, like I said, a normal bladder is an organ or a receptacle which contracts and relaxes around, an organ which allows us to hold urine for that amount of time till we land up with any kind of disease, which is OAB or UTI or this one. The bladder lining, which is a gag lining, a lining of the mucous lining, which actually protects the mucosa per se or epithelial layers around. Something goes wrong out here, which could be n number of theories which rotate around, not in the domain of the discussions we're looking at practicality today. Somewhere this entire gag layer has gone haywire. They talk about women going through this recurrent urinary tract infection, getting it damaged, immunological changes happening in the bladder, getting it damaged, angiogenesis and frequent changes happening in the bladder level and changes happening as a result of gag getting destroyed. So there's neurological, immunological, and local and a UTI theory, and all theories go on. But finally, that line, the blue line, is what disappears around completely, and that is what brings us to a situation which is, so that blue line being disappeared from that area, the urothelium is exposed to the solutes in the urine. The incriminating solute called potassium, which now is able to easily look at the bladder lining internally, irritates the C fibers in the lamina propria. So there's an irritation and a discomfort, while the urine, which should have been contained in the lumen, is actually touching the urothelium, and as a result of which, there's always a pan inclination happening around. So the gag layer missing, defective urothelial layer happening around, irritating solutes given a trouble. And this was probably the modus operandi of a provocative test, which has now been dissipated completely. We don't even discuss it, potassium sensitivity. So we're looking at a vicious cycle of something going wrong somewhere, where a bladder insult of a localized kind, which possibly could be chronic infection. That's where they rate women getting more infection than men, where the epithelial layer undergoes a dysfunction. The urine touches that potassium, which is an incriminated solute that actually moves all the way into the interstitium and brings about activation of C fibers and the release of substance P and the discomfort, the pain. Mast cells getting activated, histamine release going on, and the entire theory of that allergic reaction activating itself, causing more injury happening locally, is what is a vicious cycle which is happening extremely silently inside with no objective phenomena picked up in any of the investigation that you and I did. Sadly, there are no working markers at this point in time in the world which could be used to n number of patients with a kit that would be available, like the kits helping us to actually take our subject off the day moving forward. So when does IC begin? Nobody knows. Like, when does a gray hair started becoming black to gray? Nobody knows. But over the decades, a black hair turned gray. Over the years, somebody underwent an aging, like the prostate from 20 grams to became 80 grams. It was a gradual phenomenon. It just happened. A gradual continuum of change. This continuum of change, only when it brings about symptoms which are progressive, with flare worsening around, bringing a debility and worsening around, that we wake up to these advanced cases around. But patients do present with flare-ups and with intermittent episodes of changes, which is brought about by the stress phenomena that they undertake or undergo, that we pick them up and probably go and don't misconstrue them as recurrent UTI. So for anybody to be labeled as recurrent UTI, it's important that we look at and necessarily do a proper urine routine and culture. Look at their pus cells or WBCs. Wish the word pus cells disappeared, and AUA should look into that. And we had WBCs as inflammatory cells, looking at that. Then we look at inflammation as a part of, unfortunately, the pancystitis. Looking at bacterial cultures and looking at there are no bacterial cultures, therefore it is not a urinary tract inflammation, but an inflammation which is going on there. And as it moves from a mild to moderate to a severe symptoms around, there are changes happening because the pancystitis, urine hitting the urothelium, and there is that pan inflammation happening, the lamina propria and the muscle layers shrinking around. Many of them land up with a small stage or end stage bladder with a composite fibrous bladder where you land up doing a substitution. The problem, therefore, for a doctor, which is a gynecologist, urogynecologist, a urologist, a pain therapist, or somebody very holistic looking at the disease from outside,
understand that there is an overlapping feature of multiple things happening together. For a male, it's a male organs and multiple things happening as it happened to the 54-year-old male. And nobody was ever wrong as a urologist treating him so well, taking the evidence forward in refractory situations from medical to minimally invasive, to minimally invasive botulinum toxin, but his overactive bladder phenomenon didn't recover. His only thing which recovered was his obstructive warding. But he still continued to strain to empty his bladder. So there are confusable diseases which happen around because the entire situation in his gamut is looked at, crosstalk and bladder being at the center of it. Isn't it a very difficult and a unique disease that you and I are dealing with? We really are. Of the diseases that I have talked in my lifetime and diseases which I have been taught and trained in my training days at CMC Vellore and Jaipur Pondicherry and having been at Ramachandra Medical College University for a decade, they look forward to these kind of patients are most difficult to treat. They were most difficult because you never know when they would come. When they would come would be a flare or would be a continuing chronic changes where they seek another opinion before they look at those strong psychosomatic thoughts that they bothers them. Therefore, the variable presentations that we see, which could start with very vague symptoms not related to a UTI or a UTI itself as a flare which could be outset, things have dramatically changed. Patients have agonized themselves, lived, and would say, you are the last doctor I'm seeing, doctor, whoever they come and see and say, could you help me out, please? Well, they continue to live on agony. And many of these patients do get the therapy and treatment finally to get a cure. So while patients have been missed, we missed the boat in the era where we could prevent the term recurrent UTI for everybody. The vast age group, which late in the 20s to late in the 60s, 70s, represented are majority of them females. Female preponderance out here, like gender preponderance in various diseases, there's a high preponderance rate of anything between 5 to 9 is to 1 in females to males. Sadly, the disease is progressive and disabling, not only for the symptomatology, but also for the pathology to progress. And therefore, as we're waking up right now with the subject being defined and redefined, and we're waking up so strong and tall, with guidelines that we also created for ourselves as working principles. There are many more treatment modalities and now 6 years by the AUA. We look at the era where there were no past guidelines. They were missing multidisciplinary teams on any subject of overlap and therefore we had never partnered our gynecologists and vice versa to look at these patients that deserve something more. We missed the multimodal therapy at the onset of these symptoms and beyond because it's just not one symptom of fever or cough we need to treat. We need to treat their pain, their discomfort, their frequency urgency, their progression of change, their flare-ups, and obviously their mind and body. So we're looking at multiple treatments required, therefore multifactorial, multimodal, and I'm sure I, you, me alone cannot do it. It's we. So the we that we do is important. Men are not immune to it. Men are incorrectly diagnosed too as prostatodynia, as non-bacterial prostatitis. An era would come where we could be able to streamline and give them a definition where men could be picked up early. All the early stages may be subtle or only as flares and thus wrongly limited as infections with cultures turning negative and they could possibly then continue to live at baseline symptoms with the infection or a flare-up being treated around. So when we logically treat somebody for a UTI, which could in these situations be a flare-up causing as a result of UTI, you've got to look back and say, are you comfortable at the end of your UTI? Everything got recovered, the bacteria has been killed, the tissue inflammation gone. Are you comfortable? And they would say, no, I've been having this for the last 6 years. 7 episodes of UTI, the UTI treatment treated got well, but my symptoms only worsened thereafter, which means that we have missed the boat there too. Exacerbations do happen during menstruation, ovulation, OCPs, physical and emotional stress and whatnot. Therefore, a lot of empathy and sympathy is a part and parcel of treatment in this disease, which has got connotations of negative symptomatology, negative quality of life completely. Patients notice also that they have a food diary. And I must confess that Taneja, you have been our epitome of this subject in the country. You looked at this food diary as a good strength, and therefore Dr. Nilanjana came up with a very important diet book, which I've not projected here, but the diet book on IC patients is a wonderful book on the Google and available at Amazon. But Dr. Nilanjana brought about the book last year, released at the Gibbs Fourth back in Mumbai. And I respect that the patients have complained, and she has gone all the way over years of work with Dr. Taneja to actually look at the food diary of these patients and how to order it. Awesome work. Completely. I commend you all to very high levels. So when patients notice that coffee, alcohol, carbonated drinks, citrus, tomatoes, and dark chocolates exacerbate symptoms, they may laugh at it. And somebody in the family may laugh at it. But they know what to eat and what not to eat. And that is where the crux of matter is. That means the metabolites, which actually are filtered and brought in the urine, could be giving symptoms too. And they could be activating those C fibers and the various nerve fibers altogether. So there is so much that the urothelium and the lamina propria is going as an insult, where food diary is an important part of the diary in evaluation of these patients. So please believe patients when they say that I ate something, I had loose motion. Please believe them. You believe them. You also believe them when they ate something and they had got discomfort in urine, because they're right. They know what to eat, what not to eat. Therefore, diagnosis of all these patients is for anything between 6 weeks to 6 months without urinary infections is when we look at it. It's more complicated because frequency urgency symptoms are primarily bladder symptoms, but often can be secondary to pelvic muscle spasms. So we suggest bladder component of a disease, but look at and assess pelvic floor muscles. And the Campbell's 12th, flow, 12th edition of urology, which I looked at, this page number is in 5,400 something, where they look at myofascial bands. Only when we do more rectal examinations or more vaginal examinations in men and women do we understand that what are those strong, tight myofascial bands which are contracted, which need to be released by our physiotherapists and physiatrists. And make no mistake, in every city and country where we live and work in, physiotherapist, physiatrist, pain therapist are a very important, intricate part of this therapy. So we cannot belittle that. They may be behind the scenes. We may pick up the patients earlier as clinicians, but a pain therapist, a physiatrist, a physiotherapist, and I know colleagues in Delhi and Mumbai, in Rajkot, yeah, in Rajkot, obviously, forget. In all the cities where we have worked, where there are members, where are teams, we know that there are pain therapists as an intricate part completely of the entire teamwork in bladder pain syndrome. Dyspareunia may be due to bladder pain, vulvar pain, or pelvic muscle spasm, and therefore good history and physical examination can be established. Pelvic pain can be due to bladder pain, vulvar pain, pelvic floor spasticity, endometriosis also, and therefore again good history and physical examination. Therefore, there is no substitute to what we need to look at. Yeah, I'm looking at timelines too as we move forward. I'm looking at the investigations to diagnose my patient. So we back at Gibbs and we back in guidelines have looked at, and we will, that's already in the guidelines, I've not put forward, but practically we look forward to a lot of history taking in them, a lot of physical examination in them, and be able to clinically come to a level that, okay, this patient is fitting into this and fitting into that. That is where we will look at talking to them, talking to family, give them to ask them to come back with a wording diary, and look at scoring patterns, evaluate them basically, and then move up the ladder compared to somebody who comes on day one with a semi-emergency kind of situation, suffering and absolutely exacerbated. So there could be a patient who could be A, somebody could be C, somebody could be Z in the clinical patterns and the presentations that they have. And therefore, investigations to diagnose them is not necessarily always an exclusion, but we look at few things to be excluded for sure. And therefore, while we look at the clinical evaluation, we look at the basic evaluation of urine and proving that they are not UTIs or they don't have multiple RBCs, looking at microscopic hematuria, possibly a carcinoma in situ, or a genitourinary tuberculosis in a country like India. We look at scoring them as a pain score, as a bladder score. It gives us an idea for us to treat them on their pain and overactive bladder competence. And then look at advance only if needed. And that's where a gynecologist can score very high, because she can start the whole workup, involve her urologist, involve a pain therapist, involve a physiatrist, look at her own evaluation, and I think a team will work. And that's where a cystoscopy in cases which are refractory, in cases which are progressive, in cases which don't normally meet the eye with history and physical examination, and looking at rarely if a biopsy, if there is something incriminating, is what it look at. So when you look at classifying and identifying these patients back in your clinic from tomorrow morning, it is all about all women in a gynecology clinic or a urology clinic who visit your clinic. If they come and look at you, you look at and define who are those patients who by the definitions of the Gibbs and the ESSIC are about persons with pelvic pain, pressure, or discomfort. So that's the definition where all women who come to you and those who have pelvic pain, pressure, and discomfort, and those who also have urinary urgency, forced frequency, and dysuria could actually be patients with target disease. That means we are trying to identify the right patient. Not every OAB and not every UTI could be having the same phenomenon. So long-standing, anything between 6 weeks to 6 months and beyond, patients having chronic symptoms of pelvic pain, pressure, or discomfort, they say this is what it is. Could be anything. Could be endometriosis. Could be a lot of things around. But if they also have post frequency, urgency, frequency, and dysuria, then you're possibly looking at somebody who may be wrongly treated in the past with something, and they could be the patient with target disease. Which means that we wake up to our own patients and our repertoire of so many patients in the treasury ventures, and our new patients who will visit from tomorrow onwards as a budding urologist, as a student, as a practitioner of the art, as gynecologist. They'll be looking at considering patients for diagnosis of bladder pain. For all new patients who have got storage symptoms along with pain, along with complaints of dyspareunia, as a 39 years old young girl or a 22 years old said that my pelvis was on fire, and we look at many of them getting relieved partially or completely with passing urine, we get to know more about them. That means we move faster on the algorithm and take them forward to treatment. Compared to those patients who have come, who have stopped coming, who have come and not come unless it's 2 words, know, they are refractory on the treatment for recurrent UTI, not got the result on chronic pelvic pain where everything is exacerbated and they complain of pain in introitus, they hold their introitus and come and say, doc, it's so painful there. And the many of our patients who have been overactive bladder and treatment failures, could they be fitting into this? I'm not sure. You've got to look at all our OABs who have failed. OABs could have failed partly because our therapy or dosage may have been wrong. That's where we do at a combination right now with beta-3 agonist and an anticholinergic, looking at giving them the right dose. All of us know that overactive bladder is a lifestyle disease and maybe a lifelong too. We got to bring them to non-bothersome levels. While we look at that, those patients who are still refractory on overactive bladder and may possibly go up on the arm for treatment by botulinum toxin, we may look at those who have got pain. So we will probably prevent somebody who has got pain, discomfort, dyspareunia, etc., from getting a botulinum toxin or getting a TURP or getting a hysterectomy. And this could be our treatment failures from medical to surgical side. And finally, many patients who are women have concurrent endometriosis or not endometriosis but failed treatment because they were treated as endometriosis. So both of them could be considerations of many of my patients who have still suffered from this. So we talked about baseline investigations as a part of clinical history and evaluation. And we look at 3-day warning diarrhea. And warning diarrhea can be beyond this too if it's a research purpose for the ICS, but I think we look at 3-day warning diarrhea and get a lot of answers on that. Food diarrhea, and there's nothing less than about the book I talked about. Food diarrhea is all about identifying the flare of food products and drink products which causes flare around. Now we look at urine to be tested, and that's where very important for us to identify that we've got to give a proper midstream clean CAT specimen for a urine routine and urine culture. If you find persistent pyuria with negative cultures in a country like India, which is called a sterile pyuria, we'll wake up to a phenomena which is called genitourinary cuticulosis. We will not leave it. That's a deadly disease which is so silent. While trying to treat an attempted bladder pain syndrome, you can't leave a disease which can take away a complete life from being taking away the bladder as a thimble bladder, taking away a kidney, and unfortunately getting a treatment a little later. So genitourinary tuberculosis could be common in India than by resurgence of tuberculosis in even the mega cities and even in towns, looking at many aspects like it happens in tuberculosis. Partially treated UTIs could have negative cultures but have persistent UTIs, and very specific cultures may be required for the microorganisms like urea plasma, urolyticum, and chlamydia, which may continue to give UTIs in young, sexually active males and females, and possibly may not be picked up by clean cultures. When we have suspicion of urological malignancies in smokers, when we have people who have got persistent microscopic hematuria, a urine cytology, a urine microscopy, and moving up the ladder on a microscopic hematuria format and a platform will be another completely different issue. And any of them or all of them combined together, the scoring of what we create in our mind as a patient, relatives come in and we take investigative history from each of them. I think we'll have a urology referral, we'll have a cystoscopy in accordance with the local protocols earlier than later. Missing out a tuberculosis, missing out a malignancy will be a difficult situation. So while we're looking at all that, we are doing a sonography as a non-invasive investigation. We look at the bladder wall thickening, look at the upper tracts. Just giving you a small differential point, in a genitourinary tuberculosis, you'll have upper tract changes in the kidney, in the chalices. You may have hydronephrosis, hydroureternephrosis, pipe stem ureters. You may have phantom calluses. You may have different kind of calicial balloonings happening around because the kidney faces the brunt of this, and then comes the vesicoureteric junction and then the bladder. So if somebody has got a genitourinary tuberculosis where the bladder actually be at the crux of the whole problem, where a patient wakes up to situations which is very closely akin to bladder pain syndrome in the modern world, and you do a biopsy and find genitourinary tuberculosis, and you possibly put them on a stent because they have got a hydroureteronephrosis, this is something which you not find in IC bladder pain syndrome. In an interstitial cystitis bladder pain syndrome, the upper tracts are more or less preserved. You don't find a hydroureteronephrosis, you don't find ureteric strictures, you don't find phantom calluses and PUG obstructions acquired, which you will find in a genitourinary tuberculosis. So a lot of it on the ultrasonography, a very good non-invasive observer-oriented investigation, which we rely upon so frequently. In a country like India, we can repeat it every hour, every day, every month, and get a lot of it. Post-mortem CT gives us an idea that overactive bladder or the overactive component of the bladder still allows us to empty the urine. That means it's not a man or a woman with obstruction too, causing a secondary overactivity, recurrent UTIs, and a tarnishing of the urothelium. Symptom scores of a pain score, quality of life scores, all help us identify, classify these patients proceeding to treatment, and that's where our pain therapists stand very tall. It all in terms of looking at evaluating these patients, giving them a lot of mental relief. It becomes a relief not for the patient, but the entire family is agonized by this disease because they travel city to city and clinicians to clinicians. So symptom score is for evaluation for a multidisciplinary team to work looking at the empathy that we can give and say, oh, this is good enough. The last patient I saw had a very poor score, so you put enough. And mark my words, when you get through the multifactorial treatment that we do multimodally, you will in 6 weeks time bring about a symptom score and let me know what it is. So we also assess the response to therapy and therefore give patients back their answers very well. So may not need to diagnose all these. That means we say not required biopsy all the time, which was past. We don't need potassium sensitivity, but a provocative test. We don't need urodynamics unless you have got a voiding dysfunction. Imagine a woman comes with a voiding dysfunction of the kind where there's mild stress incontinence, passes urine, cannot pass, passes something, does not have a stricture, urethra, at the same time has got discomfort and pain around. You may possibly attempt a urodynamics of a very limited and a tapered and a focused kind, looking at not provoking and not messing her up, but will give us an idea because there may be more than one therapy left over. She may possibly be getting a therapy for her voiding dysfunction, for a stress incontinence, and therefore she may stand taller than normal if we possibly able to study if she allows, because urodynamics is completely wake up dynamic test happening around. Urinary biomarkers, sadly, we have none yet in clinical use for a mass use like we need. Urodynamics, therefore, as I said, is always used in conjunction with something else happening around as voiding dysfunction or corrective bladder. So the quick fix of IC bladder pain syndrome is about pain, discomfort, and pressure on bladder filling, relieved on voiding, maybe partly or completely, increased frequency of urination or urgency, forced frequency or because of pain that they cannot hold and pass urine, pelvic discomfort and multi-organ crosstalk which happens around, which progresses, and therefore we always need to involve all those specialties whom we can involve, which could be a gastroenterologist, which could be pain therapist, a gynecologist, who knows, everybody needs to be into the picture. Adjustments to life with diapers, bedwetting, no treatment, labeled mind games that they have gone through, ineffective treatments while disease progresses. The sad story, ineffective because we did not diagnose or could not diagnose because the patient didn't say. And you had those four patients coming from Delhi, from Rajkot, from Ahmedabad and Kochi, who actually could be Monday morning patients fitting somewhere in the understanding of new patients to you, but old patients to many more clinicians treated. And finally, if we miss the boat, a domain of these patients may progress. And I thanks Ms. Bakshi and many more patients who are there online today, to be understanding that they had end-stage bladders where the bladder went small and fibrous, passing 40 times a day, not able to hold a catheter also because of pain and discomfort where they underwent. Finally, a substitution cystoplasty where we gave them a new bladder that they can hold for next 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, and do very well. There's an office test which is used by many colleagues, and that again is Dr. Taneja's innovation, where we look at xylocaine sensitivity test, a positive step toward looking at, to give a xylocaine instillation into the bladder and just forget the patient for 10-15 minutes and then ask somebody to check in the team, in the lowdown in the team, maybe Monica or Shweta or somebody can look at it and say, does pain help? The patient seems to be feeling very good. That's a good news for you. So you need not go and see that. As xylocaine instillation lowdown in the team can help that, we actually got some relief from the direction of agony all the time, which means that we have got a positive, inclusive diagnosis in a patient who suffers around. So that's one of the ways the xylocaine sensitivity test became a great test and a positive test compared to the negative test which were discovered. So diagnosis of exclusion from the ESSIC published list of differential diagnosis was everything that we wanted to exclude because it was not visible on ultrasound, it was not visible on the patient's complaint. And therefore, when patient complained of all that and as a part of the guidelines, still as working principles, excluding some malignancies, looking at UTIs and therefore doing a urinary test, not looking at an overactive bladder phenomena where pain is a component of something else, or not into an evolving radiation cystitis like we have some patients up there who possibly could be troublesome, or bladder outflow obstruction and incomplete bladder emptying, or calculus, or a bladder stone like Philip Singh, physique in 1808 in the seminal article talked about, are these all symptoms akin to a bladder stone but not a bladder stone? Bladder stone could be a cause for diverticulum and diverticulitis, a pelvic organ prolapse, and a favorite endometriosis, again, a very difficult disease to treat by all gynecology colleagues, and hats off to you. I've taken up that again, a very tough domain too. So when we looked at triggering ourselves and looking at being able to identify the domains much easier and faster, we also looked at role of cystoscopy, ICBPS, and the GIBS. So the GIBS Society, which looked at this, looked at cystoscopy has got tremendous role. And why not take cystoscopy as a case-by-case phenomenon and looking at helping them out in the parishani jiski ilaaz inko mil nahi pa rahi hai. So cystoscopy to us is a diagnostic, a therapeutic, a surveillance, and a prognostic marker. We looked into all this, and this was something which we looked at and identified that we could treat them. Cystoscopy doesn't come on day one in all the guidelines, but then we look at guidelines talk about a step ladder approach up the ladder. We're looking at who this patient is. This patient may be coming at a station called X or Z compared to somebody who arrives at A and B. So we're looking at, obviously, the first part, which is projected out here in guidelines, is all about history, physical examination, evaluation, basic evaluation, studying them, scoring them, non-invasive investigation. But then all those patients who deserve to be treated are with the specialist of the art. And therefore, cystoscopy and therapy by cystoscopy and biopsy, cystoscopy and hydrodistension as a great therapy under general anesthesia only, or doing a test under general anesthesia, is all that gives us an idea. It gives us to move forward around, and therefore, cystoscopy means strong. If you look at cystoscopy, even in the guidelines of the AUA, if you look at it, may be low in the pattern, but then the right patient deserves it at the right point. And that's where Gibbs guidelines goes very heavy. If you don't have your own Gibbs guidelines, kindly send me a mail at my email address, and I will be keen to send you as soon as possible. So, bladder pain syndrome is a clinical diagnosis which a patient told you, you evaluate. Treatment starts when the patient fits into the jigsaw of the diagnostic conundrum. And during the treatment phase, you look at everything during a cystoscopy, which is a bladder volume. Identifying other bladder pathologies, and in a country like India, where TB as it is at its resurgence in not only in the Dharavis and the slums, but also in the upmarket locations and in bigger towns and cities. You also look at identifying Hunter's lesion, which has a different therapy altogether, and identifying glomerulations with or without Hunter's lesions. So biopsy per se is not required in a treatment, but we look at refractory symptoms, progressive symptoms, disabling symptoms. A cystoscopy helps us to identify those areas which are looking difficult and different from other areas, that there are global changes or localized changes. And we do biopsies to identify that there is no carcinoma in situ, there's no eosinophilic cystitis, there's no TB cystitis. And that would be picked up by one single sentence that biopsy shows a chronic edematous spine cystitis with mast cell infiltration, which could be up and down in the counts. There could be some mucosal ulcerations, and there could be chronic lymphocytic infiltration as a part and parcel of this entire problem. So when we look at cystoscopy, we also look at other pathologies, we look at presentation, we look at variables, we look at the evolving changes happening around. Anatomical capacity is assessed best only under general anesthesia. We cannot err on our part by looking at the functional bladder capacity under a cystoscopy. Functional bladder capacity on a frequency volume chart is the highest capacity that the patient is able to hold. That means under living conditions, under awake condition, what does the patient hold? For you and me, it is early morning wake up urine, which is the largest amount of wake up, because we sleep and snore 8 hours these days, where we are trying to evolve ourselves into a new way completely. So to identify the right kind of disease is important. Glomerulations are those pinpoint hemorrhages, and they are completely global, the global phenomena. They're not a sine qua non anyway, but we also see glomerulations in very many more diseases like radiation cystitis, post-chemotherapy patients who have got bladder disuse or diverted for many more years and chronically underfilled also can have this. As urologists, we know that 80 to 20% of patients, when we take for a TURP or a basic cystoscopy, we do find some glomerulations, not necessarily global, but do find it. Glomerulations are those pinpoint hemorrhagic spots which are visible. You saw in the first cystoscopic finding, the woman at 39 years had got Hunter's lesions, which were lesions surrounded by radiation, by the changes in the vascularity surrounding it. You saw those tears happening as we started cystoscopy in less than a minute. You found that they had glomerulations as the bladder filled up, as the bladder cannot hold beyond a point in time. Changes have happened from the level of mucosa down to the submucosa lamina propria. And you have those reminders of Hunter's lesions, the central lesions with surrounding pictures that you saw in that video. So cystoscopy also the therapeutic effect, and that's where urology and urogynecology colleagues do a cystoscopy and hydrodistension and not hydrodilatation. We don't tear it across. We do a cystoscopy as a mechanism where we may be promoting small microscopic tears happening as a distension of the mucosa beyond the systematic capacity. Normal sand is 60 centimeters of water, keeping in anything from 1 to 2 minutes and filling it for a while and keeping it for again 2 to 3 to 5 minutes and doing few cycles of that up and down, helping us to stretch the bladder to capacity where the nerve endings are where the mucosa is stretched, the nerve endings are a little stretched around, and where there's no forced or pressure hydrodistension. This helps us, the bladder actually then gets a little bit of finding where there's early relief for 1 to 3 months. And this hydrodistension has been capably a good stopgap therapy while we look at all other therapies and replenishing the gag layer around. So we are, We look at a therapeutic where we find Hunter's lesion. And Hunter's lesion is about spreading out injection triamcinolone into that by injectable therapy through the cystoscopy route, or by resecting the Hunter's lesion, or by fulgurating the Hunter's lesion by a low grade current. Or we're looking at surveillance by cystoscopy, where we monitor the progression and changes in refractory cases, where for the first 3 to 5 years was very tough. we made changes around, we treated her, and then she says, I'm feeling very good. When she feels very good, we put them on a surveillance by a clinical evaluation, by frequency volume chart, and sometimes when you have other lesions and you have small bladder capacities which stabilize to some level, we monitor that, monitor the stability of the bladder capacity. So cystoscopy has a diagnostic and a therapeutic and a prophylactic and a surveillance rules in such patients. But as a prognostic rule, in terms of if the bladder capacity is too small, we know that irrespective of whatever we give as a combination therapy will not work. If the involvement is so global, we will not wait for it forever. If the recurrent Hunter lesion developing around this bladder is diseased, if the bladder is too fibrous on the needle for botulinum toxin, botulinum toxin has come up as a large subset of work right now in Taiwan and other countries around, where they looked at breaking the mucosal cycle with 100 units of botulinum toxin, where they break the angiogenesis, where they break the entire factors lining up. So botulinum toxin is coming up in a big way for that. While patients undergoing dilemmas of seeing multiple teams in various centers, continued years of suffering, sometimes more than a decade, and attempted treatment procedures or treatment therapies, medical managements, without lack of objective of many of these, with various other specialties beyond the teamwork that we practice in the country and the world, confusable disease of overlap actually confuse all of us, the quality of life of these patients progresses. Therefore, we're looking at, I did talk about this, that they have this, for every single patient diagnosed as ICBPS, 5 may remain undiagnosed. For every single patient diagnosed ICBPS, who has seen 7 to 9 doctors already for the vague and changing nature of the presentation, while we get to see these patients, the quality of life of these patients gets poorer with passing time. Therefore, halting them, breaking the cycle of vicious change which is happening around, will actually be dramatically reducing them from getting completely to be crippled around. They're physically, sexually, and otherwise emotionally too disturbed around. And we look at the various guidelines where European Association, the World Associations, and various associations have taken it forward. The Canadian Association also come up with its own guidelines. But we look at the working principles that we evolved back in India. We looked at everybody, and we looked at how does a clinician take it forward. So you get a chance to looking at the American Association of Urology. You get a chance to look at all of them. And therefore, we agreed positively at Gibbs to an inclusive definition. We looked at pain or discomfort in the lower abdomen and or the urogenital area, that entire area of the organ and the organs of crosstalk, for more than 3 months duration, which is a chronic phenomena, which is worst when the bladder is filled up. The bladder cannot fill up in all the cases because of the hypersensitivity that it goes through as a result of the absence of the gag layer, along with one or more low urinary tract irritative symptoms. That means the storage symptoms of the bladder cannot be sourced because of frequency, urgency, nocturia, getting up, discomfort, pain, with or without standard stigmata, which could be picked up on cystoscopy, and therefore we at GIPS stand taller in terms of identifying patients earlier by scoring, by patterns, by history, by their past, and taking cystoscope earlier than later, provided another discernible pathology is not there, which should be excluded in patients. Obviously, we live in a country where tuberculosis has been rampant in the past and has an upsurge. Therefore, looking at diagnostic tests, we should have some tests which should be completely decried, like the potassium test and the biopsy, which is not required in many patients. So the roles of test gradually as we invade gets lesser and lesser while we identify such patients. Finally, the last few minutes, the management and bottom line, which is so much there in the literature always, so much in the Gibbs guidelines that we would pass on to you. It is all about looking at pathology and replacing the gag layer. The gag layer or the bottom line is a major aspect of the entire pathology. Today, we are lucky enough compared to the era 10 and 20 years ago that we have got the very medicine which replaces the pernicious gag layer made in our own country at various centers. We've got to treat the symptoms of the patient because they have got pain frequency, urgency. All that is something which you need to treat as a part of the entire syndrome. While we're doing all that, we know the disease sometimes has a large domain where patients can progress to an end stage bladder, and we've got to prevent them from going to the end stage bladder. So management, again, like evaluation, had different needs. Management, again, has got bottom lines. And we look at agreeing to it on a consensus completely. And that's where I look at that second tier of management at the AUA update on the IC bladder pain syndrome, where there is an oral therapy called pentosan polysulfate, a sodium pentosan polysulfate, which is available from the German Beechwood, which helps us in treating this patient's much better. So we look at etiology and IC. We're looking at positioning ourselves as treating on multimodal therapy and then getting our colleagues helping us out on the therapy. So we looked at this causative requirement and we look at how to treat such patients. So trying to open the Pandora's box, we look at a lot of work to be done in repairing the epithelial dysfunction of these patients around. We need to look at that subject. You also need to look at modulating the neural activity as we modulate the urothelium. I look at the insult disappearing around, and therefore the activation of C fibers, release of substance P, and more discomfort of the neuralgic kind goes down. We're also looking at helping them out to stabilize the mast cells and mast cell release. We're also looking at treating their overactive bladder components, and that's where sodium pentose and polysulfate, looking at the gag layer, is an important drug therapy. It's available in ADL, ladies and gentlemen. My friends who have already been treating it understand that we need to give it for 3 to 6 months minimum. Look forward to bring about an isolation changes in the gag layer around in patients who would require and possibly would get improved with therapy. We have this tricyclic therapy, which is a therapy which helps us to modulate the neural activity and helping them to actually stabilize these patients around on the discomfort levels around. At this point, I was also confessed that we have got the gabapentins and pregabalins as a part of the therapy, where we look at modulating that therapy and giving the nerve component completely away. And our pain therapists are very tall in giving those therapies, rightly so, so that patients don't have the ill effects or the incidental side effect that they don't expect. I look at stabilizing mast cells and antihistamine therapy of the kinds of Atarax that we give, ranging from a small dose and climbing up the ladder on the strong dose, giving them not a resolution alone on the mast cell stabilization, but giving them no side effects around is also part of the therapy. And then let's not forget that overactive bladder symptoms are huge symptoms. These patients have symptoms of overactive bladder. That means irritative symptoms. Don't let them go forward. By the disease is progressing, the bladder capacity may be getting smaller, as you saw in the two different patients of different kinds. We want to look at treating them with overactive bladder symptoms. And that's where a urologist, a gynecologist, a therapist at this point in time is absolutely totally looking at whom to give a single therapy, whom to give a combined therapy, looking at ultrasounds, not raising the residual volumes and pushing them to a UTI. We also look at many patients in early diseases, and there's a huge amount of paper at this point in time today morning which talks about these patients benefiting early when picked up, like Professor Kuo and team back in Taiwan and in various Eastern Asian countries, where we look at botulinum toxins and early therapy modulating the urothelium and looking at the angiogenesis and the entire aspect around. So all these therapies do work around. The work on folate metabolism, folic acid, has come up in a very big way. I speak so today because there's a huge amount of evidence on the folic acid therapy and folate therapy. And that is a therapy which is establishing itself very much. Things which were missed in our jigsaw, in our mind, is actually already with you as gynecologists who use folic acid for a different level altogether. So folic acid therapy is a regenerative therapy, and multiple aspects of work in the bladder is an important therapy. Sodium pentothan polysulfate, that being available in the country at this point in time, replaces and replenishes gag layer of the urinary bladder, which is that layer in the mucous membrane, which helps us to allow prevent the assault or the insult happening deep inside. It happens to be oral definitive curative therapy, while supportive and symptomatic measures on overactive component, pain component, other component goes on. It is available in India as 100 milligram thrice daily therapy in empty stomach. We forewarn many patients of the women kind that they may have some extra losses of hair in the telogen phase, but that's a part and parcel, and many women don't lose their hair, so we need to inform them but not to worry about it. Now, I gather that we have got availability of this coming up in next 2 years' time in Europe and Scandinavia, where 100 milligram tablet may become 75 milligram twice daily with nanoparticles and with phospholipid attachments on them. And that will help us out to look at a therapy of gag layer with a lesser dose involvement required, because we'll have more bioavailability right now compared to whatever we have right now. The bioavailability in the bladder layer, well, it needs to increase, could be good. And that's where many colleagues also do an instillation therapy of the powder form, which we paid forward to look at the intravesical therapy form, which could come up in this. So the effective visible therapies, both to the patient on a monotherapy and on patients on multiple therapies, on these kind of ulcerated patients, it takes minimum of 3 to 6 months to help in long-term replenishment of the gag layer, which sometimes can land in a larger way around. Interstitial cystitis bladder pain syndrome finally and truly is a treatable phenomena with a teamwork. There's no more a taboo of I have an IC and therefore I cannot go to my doctor, because patients are well-read. They are on their own forums and they understand how and when to go. And that's where Gibbs has come up tall in terms of partnering with the patients too. And when we have our sessions on, and we do this brain work of 1.5 days at Gibbs on the live meetings, we have a complete patient session like it happens in Essex session around. And that's where we look at identifying patients and let patients speak to doctors. We understand the patients who are going therapy and not undergone therapy and still refractory to therapy are the best ones as to what they speak. Today they can't speak live to us, and therefore we caught their stories to you. But finally we look at evaluating these patients and stabilizing them. At least we stabilize and break the natural history of the progressive disease. We identify the confounding factors which could worsen them. And we put all these measures at outset in a multifactorial disease which requires a multimodal therapy by multiple disciplines. Therefore, we need to put these long-lasting measures today and today, which means in 2020, we wake up to a phenomena where we want to save the bladder from being an end-stage bladder. So I see bladder pain syndrome is completely treatable. The new headline should be, I love my urologist, I love my gynecologist, I love my pain therapist, I love my doctor. Impossible to possible, because it is finally treatable and curable to a level where we can cure them and we could take them forward. Sadly, we should not be letting everybody go to that level where the bladder is completely diseased to a small capacity thimble bladder, which bladder is 150 or 200 ml bladder capacity, which cannot store an adult input of urine and therefore has to be substituted or augmented around. All those who deal with interstitial cystitis bladder pain syndrome should drive up this wake-up call to patients who suffer in agony. Life comes a full circle when we understand the agony of these patients. There is an early morning, 7:30 morning photograph from the balcony that we live. The roads have become empty. Rashmi clicks these pictures as a dermatologist and a photographer and picks up these and passes on to us to help us out in many of these patients. So while we all have combined and individual dreams and visions, the visions are every urologist, every gynecologist, and every clinician, and in fact, everybody who is involved with the urinary aspect should know, treat, and heal this entity to the highest levels, like a basic course and move up the ladder to the highest possible level that you can combine to your team. So the vision is to uplift each of these patients who live in such a low self-esteem, emotional state of discomfort, punctuated days and nights in agony and discomfort where the bladder is giving them a source of pain all the time, more so when the bladder is filled up. It is important that we must save this end-stage bladder and help them out to very high levels and take it forward. And therefore, awareness of the kinds that we do at Coquelam in hospital and we do at Gibbs are important to take it forward at home. To UGIBS, Gibbs is a very important society today because it's a global platform which has met for the last 4 years, and we were into our 5th year where we were trying to move out from Mumbai and go to the city of Delhi and host it there. We gather that we'll continue to still attempt to host it later in the year if things go cool enough. We may possibly look at a CME program. We may look at Gibbs hosting this. And it's possibly the dates on end of August and early September, if things go well, we may look at it completely as a tool on the internet at this point in time. Wish and pray we are able to host this as an awareness for patients and for doctors. I look at it from my Twitter handle, from my YouTube and from my Instagram handle all the time. And people have connected me and connected my colleagues in the Gibbs working group, in the Gibbs core society. We look forward to creating this awareness to the two-tier cities and to my colleagues in general practice, my colleagues in gynecology, and we look at awareness and awareness and awareness. And we go back to the patients and make them aware by many forums, like the fora we had in the morning where patients were made aware about it. I think we have reached where we want to treat them. It could be Dial U for urology, and we stand very tall in many urological subjects, but we have agreed to negotiate this change, the bend in the road, which was not the end of the road. Not the end of the road for the doctors and patients, because we did not fail to negotiate the curve. We negotiated that very well at Gibbs and at various bladder pain syndrome societies across the country and the world. With various teamwork that we do today and tomorrow, we look forward to bringing this change for the patients who go to the agony around. So as we embrace changes for success, we identify and bring about paradigm shifts in the subject. We have moved from many unknowns to a lot of knowns today. We have got leaders in our country, in each city, who are a part of the Gibbs, who are a part of the Bladder Pain Syndrome Society, who look forward to treating these patients around and who have got their own work, which is moving forward. We know we have got leaders in this audience today, and we've got leaders who work, could come up to the global platform and probably help us to change the goalposts as we understand more of our work. So at GibbsSociety.org or GibbsSociety.org. I would look forward to people looking at the guidelines that we have out there. Otherwise, my email and emails are available. I did talk about folate, and folate metabolism is a very important metabolism that we're looking forward to and we're moving forward on that subject. So we look at this article, which was published in International Urogynecology Journal. I could pass on this article to anybody who sends me a mail on that. And probably this could be also a part of the therapy. As a part of therapy, because gynecologists already are deep in folate. As urologists, as neurologists, we understand that folate metabolism is an important metabolism and at microscopic level in that allergic phenomena, in that histamine-mediated process happening down there at the bladder level.
And that's where all these new subjects which had gone back and 2 and 4 have come back. I looked at today morning into various other work happening around. The subject is not dead. The subject is not over. The handshake may be dead or handshake may be deadly. But the subject is not dead and deadly. The subject is very much in the domain of urogynecologist and the Gibbs format. We're looking at various works which are happening across the world. I'm looking at clinical trials back around where they're looking at low energy shockwave therapy as a part of global pain syndrome. And the enrollment and management is happening at this point in time in the Western world while we look at it. So low energy shockwave, who knows, possibly could be a therapy while we look at new therapy. Hyperbaric oxygen as a part of interstitial cystitis, bladder pain syndrome, could be a part of therapy. And though enrollments have happened, the whole trial has been closed and we're looking forward to the final results of this trial which could come up. So while we look at a multifactorial work in a disease of agony, in a disease of anguish, disease of pain, disease of so much of discomfort day and also at night, we are looking at, in the words of these needy individuals who do have a very difficult phenomena day and night, and the basic necessities of life about urination has gone haywire. We're looking at using this very important old adage, a stitch in time saves nine. That means it's time to give them back their days and nights minus the pain. It's to give them their self-esteem and confidence. It is to give these all needy individuals the right direction. And only a focused mind and a clinic can do this. Only a focused teamwork can do this. And I look forward to each individual at this point in time becoming their own mini teams in various cities, countries around. Like the world will glitter soon and India is glittering on many subjects. This subject will possibly move forward much better on the fifth year of GIPS and much better as we host you. So we look at various ages of presentation because very young and very old presented. The presentations are, as I said, very vague at the outset and presentations can be variable related to the chronicity of the phenomena and the flares. We look at the needs of these patients around. Somebody may require an oral therapy. Somebody may require a cystoscopy and hydrodistension. And somebody sadly has moved all paces away and has moved to a level where the bladder has now become akin to a thimble or a very small bladder and possibly cannot hold an adult bladder capacity day and night and would require a substitution cystoplasty like what we do at Coquelin Hospital, where you move from an open surgery to a robotic surgery and we have augmented these bladders without giving them any discomfort and incisional hernias in future. We're looking at expectations of the patient being matched. This is a different disease altogether compared to all the diseases that we pick up on the sonographies and the CT scans. It's truly a challenge. Possibly we cannot screen them by going to their homes, but we can make them aware. And that awareness is a dream process that we take up in our own way by the social medias that I look at the YouTube, I look at the Twitter and looking at the Instagram handle and moving forward. Because in this disease, unlike any other disease, a treatment delayed, our lives lost, our families lost. It is important that we look at, in my end is my beginning on this subject, because I am hopeful that few of you have got enthused and many of you are doing great work on this subject. It could not have been beyond this point in time that I could have taken this forward. But this whole presentation will go online at some point in time. My email flashes there all the time, and that's the mail where I would be keen to answer your questions today. Apart from if any questions which have come up around, I look forward to taking the subject to the highest possible level. Is it possible, Rehan, to actually blow up the questions on the main box, or at least many questions which have come up, I look at. Can you, as I stop sharing my slide, I leave my email for the GIPS guidelines, which I can pass on to you. Is it possible, Rehan, that you and team can actually blow up the questions directly here, please?
Yes, sir. Please allow me a minute.
Yeah, so we can actually answer two of them and look at how do we take it forward. So I can see one question which is sitting on my phone is that can women in their 70s and 80s also have, so it doesn't see an age. That's a great question from a gynecology colleague from Bhopal. I look forward to answering you many of these questions. Yes, so it does not see an age. Late 20s and late 70s also could have a disease. The woman in late 70s did not catch up yesterday. So she must be suffering for quite some time. As I said, we missed the boat in that era where we looked at all diseases with different paraphernalia. It could be possible that we may have missed this patient complaining at that point in time. So it was important that we look at it. So two patients, both young in their 20s, both have symptoms of bladder pain. Both don't show features on cystoscopy, but both had squamous metaplasia, patches visible in trigone. Is there a correlation? But Sarita, thank you for that question. And there are so many questions which I can actually look at happening right now. So yes, great enough. Being a urogynecologist, you stand very tall in the city of Mumbai and the country to take the subject to such high levels. Having understood this patient, looked at their cystoscopy and look at that squamous metaplasia is a change happening in the bladder. If you did a biopsy and looked at squamous metaplasia, then you possibly picked up a new entity altogether. Like we pick up eosinophilic cystitis or different things. You got to follow up these patients around. Squamous metaplasia should not be a squamous cell carcinoma. These are very young patients in your understanding, and these patients need to be looked into with a lot of pinch of salt. So glad that you decided to do a cystoscopy because these were refractory symptoms. Your medical management was not helping them being treated, and you took it forward to the next level around. Yes, Dr. Nathan. By one question, do you agree with many of our seniors whose terminology use pseudomembranous trigonitis for which treatment is urethral dilatation? So when you look at trigonitis, urethral dilatation may not be a treatment. And let's come to that. Let's come to the female urology for a short while because you have, Dr. Nathan, you have put up this question around. So many of these terms are disappearing from the newer books around because we are evolving, we are narrowing and focusing our subjects and understanding our patients more in many ways right now to what our seniors and teachers could have done. They did a great job of keeping subjects alive, taught us those subjects in our own medical colleges and training so that we could stand tall, and it was that seed which became a mighty oak to actually help us understand. So I understand that there are changes happening in trigone in women during their menstrual cycles too, and that is completely in the trigone. The urethral dilatation has been used as a tool by clinicians, which includes we to blame most commonly and to gynecologists, when we have dilated urethras thinking that all urethras undergo a kind of lichen sclerosis atrophicus in females and they get obstructed and we will do wonders in dilating them. We actually stretch and tear many of these urethras which don't need. So calibration by bougie bowl, which Dr. Adit Vaze actually demonstrated and talked about, is using a bougie bowl and identifying which is a stricture, which is not a stricture, and looking at which patient deserves a dilatation or not a dilatation is similar to akin to a male optical internal urethrotomy. If you have a mucosal stricture, then only you do an OIU. The strictures are deep enough, and if they on sonos, spongiosogrammas or ultrasounds, which talk about of that there is a fibrosis in the spongiosum, doing a urethrotomy may do no good. We do a urethrotomy in many of these strictures, hoping that we could be able to beat the natural process of progression and fibrosis, leave catheters, continue dilating and calibrating them. And many of these male strictures come back with a bang, with longer length of strictures and more deeper strictures and more fibrosis. Similarly, to dilatation, a urethral dilatation or a pseudomembranous trigonitis may not be a kind of a blanket statement around. Yes, female urethral dilatation has been practiced, and calibration of these female urethras is a part and parcel of more of urogynecology. When we do cystoscopy, we pick up many of these patients have got tight urethra to a normal scope. And then we possibly do a Otis dilatation, Otis urethrotomies. We do a stretch, we do Hager's dilators. All those we need to be looked at and followed up very closely. We improve them to a level and let them undergo a fibrosis and turn worse in due course of time will be wrong. So all females who undergo urethral dilatation is with a lot of understanding that these patients do they deserve a dilatation, a continued dilating and causing an iatrogenic stricture and waking up to a lot of mid-urethral strictures and is a very sad situation which can happen now. So the right kind of urethra, right kind of catheterization, right kind of movement is very, very important. I can look at a question out here, which could be the last few questions that questions rolling around is about my male patients in the late 40s complain of similar phenomena. Did you write that? Yeah. My male patients with a similar phenomena, how do I treat them? So obviously remember, men go through an agony of also an organ called prostate. Male UTIs not necessarily are like female UTIs. If you abolish a male UTI, you may understand that they may also make their homes in prostate. And many of these patients will end up with prostatitis, a chronic phenomena where we have got them urine cultures negative with a discomfort and this doesn't go on and they have got perineal discomforts. And where again, we need multimodal therapy. And possibly many a times, what we do is we look at giving them the combination therapy of the Synaptols and Sensivals and pregabalins and gabapentins. And many a times we look at Dr. Navita Porowitz and many physiatrists and pain therapists helping around. So focused pelvic therapy is also a very important indicator. And when you look at the 12th edition of Campbell's Urology, they talk so much about myofascial bands, which was missing terminology in urology. So we're waking up to it completely that myofascial bands need to be broken. And you and I may not be most qualified because we as urologists and gynecologists have not done that. So pelvic muscles, pelvic floor also have these myofascial bands, which are trigger points. And these trigger points are either injected with botulinum toxin, injected with long-term anesthetics,
and also injected sometimes with placebos. Also, sometimes they are myofascial bands are broken by various massages and ultrasound therapies. Therefore, I think a pain therapy as a part of therapy many times is important. So, to identify an incriminating issue in IC bladder pain syndrome is important. And therefore, history and multifactorial assessment of these patients are very important. While we look at it, I always comment that these kind of subjects can be taken best when we take more time in histories and identify these patients. It becomes a little difficult because patients are also well-read. They come understanding this. But when we follow the Hippocratic Oath and do what we can do best, we go by chronological event of history and then clinical evaluation, and then going by various tools which you use as scoring therapies, and therefore we move forward up the ladder. Patients who have very high on the score would require a quicker and invasive kind of an evaluation. Therefore, cystoscopy stands so tall as urologists pick up cystoscopies and gynecologists too. Larita, for your case of squamous metaplasia, you need to follow them very closely because if the biopsy shows squamous metaplasia, the biopsies have been refurnished and relooked again and again, then we look to follow up these patients around because not unknowns are very young patients who have got bladder carcinoma, not unknowns are very young patients who got bladder diseases which are still unknown to the medical domain around. Friends, for the sake of being on a Sunday evening, for the sake of being multimodal, holding many of you back, and I gather a very, very huge load of people have logged in around. Thank you so much as an audience to attempt that we made. This was basically to take the subject on a flow from what patients say to where we go forward. We're looking forward to sharing screens with you on these diseases around, helping colleagues in practice in pain therapy, in physiatry, in overactivity of bladder, and identifying that various diseases like overactive bladder, decorative UTI are not bladder pain syndrome. I think I've been very, very tough on myself looking at this disease needs that addressal very strongly. And therefore, we look forward to having more platforms on these difficult diseases and connecting with our patients while we stay home and work from homes in various other fraternities, in medical fraternities, as we have opened up ourselves to emergencies and looking at many Skype consults. It also behoves that from the GIPS platforms, any platforms, you identify our patients and make them understand that the diseases are there to be treated and cured. And this disease where a patient and a doctor combine so well as team, I think we look forward to many of you combining in your teams better around. So in COVID times, when we live in tough times, GIPS offers the platform for us to be doing more live meetings in futures to come, which could be possibly next year, and many more meetings where we could connect to many of our colleagues in Western world. I can see some of our urology colleagues from UK and Scandinavia. Thank you so much for being there for this, standing by this 2 hours of presentation, and many colleagues and students from various specialties in this country. It behoves that we create such teams and probably move forward and treat these patients. There's so much in research and so much of articles coming in. I could pass on the email to those who look at more questions as they come in around and the platform could provide to help us out. But on a Sunday evening, I sign off. Thank you so much, Team Cyplamed, and thank you so much, colleagues in the GIPS core group, who have actually taken the subject to very high levels in the last 5 years, only as a team. So teamwork thrives, and teaming up with our patients in these subjects help us to identify and break the natural history of this disease much earlier. So let's do it. Let's do it again. Bye from me and bye from the entire team which hosted this program today. Thank you so much for hosting it. It's such a huge day. Thank you for no interruptions today like it happened in some of the days. There were no interruptions. And finally, signing off on 26 April, Sunday evening at 6 o'clock. We have done very well by combining. Thank you, Javed. Thank you, the entire.